हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू चैप्टर 8 सिल्क रोड बाय निक मिडलटन एंड दिस इज़ पार्ट 2. इन द पार्ट 1 राइटर एंड हिज टीम हैड कवर्ड अ जर्नी अप टू द प्लेस वेयर इट वाज अ फ्रोजन और ड्राई सॉल्ट लेक आफ्टर क्रॉसिंग अ पास ऑफ द हाइट 5500 मीटर. हियर दे हैड अ स्टीव a small break, they had a cup of tea, noodles, and they had stopped at a tire repair shop because they had suffered 2 punctures in succession. They replaced their tires, had a light meal there to continue the journey to Hor. So the next place where they had to stay was Hor. It is a place basically situated on a route from Lhasa to Kashmir. As it is written here. After reaching Hor, they came to know that it was a grim and miserable place with no vegetation whatsoever, just dust and rocks scattered with years of accumulated refuse. It was so unfortunate that the place is situated so near to the sacred lake Mansarovar, Tibet's most venerated stretch of water. So he was, sad. Writer did not think that he will get such a situation there, so near to Tibet's most sacred place, Lake Mansarovar, and it was so dirty a place. The only cafe at Hor. After reaching, writer was served with coffee by a Chinese youth in a military uniform at the cafe, which was the only cafe house there at Hor. The place was filthy, it's a very dirty, but there was one relief that he could see a distant view of mountains and Mount Kailash from one of cafe's window. So he was not much upset by the filthiness in the cafe, but he had a relief there. Writer's experience at Hor was a stark contrast to the accounts he had read earlier. He says, I remember Akai Kawaguchi, a Chinese monk, and another writer from Sweden, Swam Hedden, who praised this place a lot, and he had read them. And they became so sentimental about the sanctity and beauty of this place. But he was so sad to know the condition today, because the place was loaded with lot of refuse, dust, garbage, and he was so upset about it. Writer stay at Darchan. So the next place where they had their stay was Darchan. Writer's next stop was at the guest house at Darchan, but by that time his condition had worsened. It was the effect of the climate, the weather. He reached there at 10:30 p.m. But by the time he reached, his condition worsened. So he had a troubled night at Darchan, which was at a height of 4,660 meter high, not much higher than Rabu. His nostrils blocked and he lay down to sleep, felt tired and hungry, but he could not go to sleep. He at times woke up abruptly and thought something was wrong. He just felt strangely heavy. He tried to lay back and sleep again, but he could not. Now he was under the phobia that if he goes to sleep, he may never wake up again. So he was not allowed to sleep that night. Little voice inside him was saying, if he went to sleep, he will never wake up again. So he stayed awake all night. So it was a terrible kind of night at Darchan that he is describing. Darchan Medical College. The following morning, Seton took the writer to Darchan Medical College, the building which looked like a monastery, occupied by a doctor who seemed like any other ordinary Tibetan. Not exactly in a paraphernalia of a doctor, but he was wrapped in the Tibetan clothes. The doctor shot him a few questions. Feeling the veins in his wrist, he said, it is cold and the effect of altitude, but promise that the writer will be fine soon. The writer walked out of the college clutching suspiciously looking packet with spherical brown pellets which looked like sheep dung. The writer took them and felt the effect of the medicine. That night he slept nicely, like a log of wood, not like a dead man. So he was not troubled. This was a very, you know, comfortable night, and he had a lot of, you know, comfort because of this medicine there. Next day, after a good night's sleep, Darchan did not look so horrible. He could see the vision of Himalayas, commanded by huge snow-capped mountains. The town had a couple of rudimentary general stores selling cigarettes, that Chinese cigarettes and other basic provisions. Men gathered in the afternoon for a game of pool, while nearby women washed their long hair in icy water of a narrow brook. Brook, you know, is a you know, kind of small river. He felt relaxed, but the writer was missing something. Actually, there were no pilgrims, and he realized for the first time that his journey is ill-timed. He was early for his kora, that he was missing the company of other pilgrims, and he had come a bit earlier for this kora. So this is all for today. See you next time with another video. Have a nice time.